اتبع هداه بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. ثم أما بعد, so my dear brothers and sisters, we'll speak about understanding the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As I mentioned last week, as all of us, we study the seerah some way, somehow. We read the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in many books. A lot of books speaking about the seerah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But now I would like to be part of the seerah, part of the seerah, to apply this seerah or the history, that history in me. This is the most unique, beautiful history you can even imagine. As I mentioned last week, Muslims and non-Muslims spoke about this history. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of the great men in humanity, and the non-Muslims witness with that. That means our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the greatest man in humanity, is our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I heard one of non-Muslims once when I was teaching at the university, and he read the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, Allah, if Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam among us, he will solve the problems of the people while he's drinking cup of coffee. Subhan, I heard this statement with my own ears. He said, he will solve the problems of everybody just while he's drinking the cup of coffee. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather all of us with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannat al-Na'im, in the Firdaus al-A'la. Ameen, ya Rabbil Alameen. So my dear brothers and sisters, last week we spoke about the Islam. And what is the Islam? And what is the belief? And we said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent all the prophets and all the messengers for one mission, one duty. The duty is La ilaha illallah. That is the mission. All the prophets in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mission in the Quran, they came, اعبدوا الله ولا تشركوا به شيئا لا أريد منكم جزاء ولا شكورا. Say, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't make association with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No association with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't want anything from you. I don't want money, I don't want this, I don't want anything. Anything. So even the offer of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to leave what he's doing. And he said that what Ibn Ishaq said is not a hadith, it's utter in the history of Ibn Ishaq. Mentioned, he said, Allah, ya amma, he told his uncle, if he put the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left hand to leave this matter, I'm not going to leave this matter. So we spoke about, you know, what is the people they used to believe before the Islam. And we spoke about the Roman Empire, and we spoke about the Persian Empire, and in between the Indian Empire, and what the people believe before the Islam, before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now let's speak about usul al-Arab, the source of the Arab and their societies. Speak about the source of the Arab. What is the Arab? In summary, of course, I'm not going to details, because the whole purpose of this, I want to become, to understand the seerah. I want to see, understand those people and how to get listen in my life to apply it in our lives. This is the purpose of this, studying the seerah in this course, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. Of course, we have three types, say the Arab, say three types. Say, some they call it Al-Arab Al-Ba'idah, and Al-Arab Al-Ariba or Al-Musta'riba, and Al-Arab Al-Adnaniyah. Number one, Al-Arab Al-Ba'ida, you cannot find too much among Al-Ba'ida, they are in the past, the first Arab, the first genuine Arab, and we talk about more than 8,000 years before Christ, alayhi salam, before Isa, alayhi salam. More than 8,000 years, they live in the area where it's Yemen. And this is Ad wa Thamud wa Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned those nations and those people mentioned in the Quran, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala vanished those Arab. There's the Ad and Thamud and Al-Amalika, they were in Palestine, the and Judaith and Umayyim and Hadramaut, all this before. And every nation, they have to used to have their king. So even in small country or small cities, because they have their own king, Kalam Muluk. So subhanAllah, and this is from all the way Syria, all the way to Egypt, to this area. So everybody has their own king and they're attacking and invading each other. That was Al-Arab al-Ba'ida, or the past Arab. They are not anymore. Then Al-Arab al-Ariba, and some people call Al-Arab al-Musta'ariba. They are not the first generation of Arab, the second generation of Arab. By the way, the Arabic language is not our topic, just for the history. Say that some people, they accuse Arab or accusing Muslim them anti-Semitic. How can we anti-Semitic? And we all belong to Nuh alayhi salam and the kids of Nuh alayhi salam. We all belong to Nuh, Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, and his sons. So Al-Arab al-Ariba, the second generation, says Al-Arab, they came from Bani Qahtan and Al-Qahtaniyya, and that is the south of the Yemen. South of Yemen, and those Qahtan, this is the tribe of the Arab and the area with the Ma'an and Saba' that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned Saba' in the Quran, and Himyar, all those areas called Al-Arab al-Musta'riba, the second generation of the Arab. Whoever left after what happened to Nuh alayhi salam and these kids and perished, and then there is a new generation of the Arab, a new generation of the Arab. That was Al-Arab from the south. South of Yemen area, south of the Yemen area. Come to Al-Arab Al-Adnaniya, Al-Qarab Al-Adnaniya, Al-Adnan, that belongs, what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he's from that tribe of Arab. That tribe of Arab migrate, they migrate from Yemen to Arabia, to Arabian Peninsula, where is Mecca, right now, and Ismail alayhi salam from those people, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the descent of Ismail and Ibrahim alayhima as-salam. So, and that's his name, the kids of Ismail alayhi salam, called the Arab al-Jarahima, al-Jarahima, and this is what this Ismail alayhi salam among those Arab, and he learned the Arabic language from them. He learned the Arabic language from them. And of course, you know the story when those people, they migrate because they used to have a lot of water in the area. And the Ma'rib area, Ma'rib is in Yemen. And the dam of Ma'rib destroyed and they migrate. Some of them, they went to Arabian Peninsula, where is the Mecca right now. And some of them, they went to their cousins in Canaanites in Palestine. So some of them migrate to that area, and some of them, they came to this area where is the Mecca right now. And the Prophet Ismail, they found the Prophet Ismail alayhi salam, and they found Hajar, and they live with them because there is a water. There is a water. And they live in this area. And the highest jid, or the highest great grandfather to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam, is Adnan, and he is from the descent of Ismail alayhi as-salam, from Ismail alayhi as-salam. So I'm just trying to get to the point to those Arab, is not in details, but if you have your book, of course, the Seal of Nectars, read it, and I think in that book they have more details about this, inshallah. But I am just going to give you the past of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his great grandfathers, they are from the descent of Ismail alayhi salam and Ibrahim alayhima as-salam. I said, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Allah, when he always want to be among Ibrahim's family, we even in salah say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallayta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. So he's sending his salam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the salah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala among his father Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail alayhi salam. What is important with all this, you know, I'm just going straight to the point that those people, when they migrate to Mecca, they have become also the kids of Ismail alayhi salam, al-Qahtaniyin, they become the different tribes also, different tribes. And Quraysh from the tribe called Kanana. Quraysh from the tribe called Kanana. And that is the great grandfather, is the kid, the Fahr ibn Malik ibn al-Nadr ibn Kanana. Fahr ibn Malik ibn al-Nadr ibn Kanana. No, those names is maybe hard to memorize right now, but the whole point that Ibrahim alayhi salam is from Kanana, and Hashim, this evil Quraysh, they become different tribe, different sects, and Hashim one of those tribes. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam from Quraysh, from Kanana, from Bani Hashim. Bani Hashim, or the sons of Hashim. The sons of Hashim. And he said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, this is in Sahih Muslim, this is a hadith in Sahih Muslim. I don't think it's in your book, but this is a hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam قال, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى كَنَانَا مِنْ وَلَدْ إِسْمَعِيلِ. Kanana, the tribes of Kanana, Allah Azza wa Jalla has chosen Kanana from the sons of Ismail alayhi wasallam. وَاصْطَفَى قُرَيْشًا مِنْ كَنَانَا. The tribe of Quraysh from the tribe of Kanana. وَاصْطَفَى مِنْ قُرَيْشِ بَنِي هَاشِمْ. And the Prophet and Allah has chosen from the tribe of Quraysh, the tribe of Bani Hashim. Bani Hashim. وَاصْطَفَانِي مِنْ بَنِي هَاشِمْ. And has chosen me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the tribe of Bani Hashim. So the descendants, Ismail, then Kanana, then Quraysh, then Bani Hashim, then our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That in summary, that means that's his descent sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let's speak now about the civilizations of the Arabian Peninsula. The civilizations of the Arabian Peninsula. Now the question is, why we are studying these civilizations to get to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? To get what is the environment he used to live, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? So the Arabian Peninsula, they have different tribes, different civilizations. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before the Islam mentioned many of those tribes and those civilizations as well. The first civilization that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in Surah Saba', called the civilization of Saba' in the Yemen area. Saba'. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قَدْ كَانَ لِسَبَئٍ فِي مَسْكَنِهِمْ آيَةٍ جَنَّتَانِ عَنِ الْيَمِينِ وَعَنِ الشِّمَالِ. So Allah Azza wa Jalla described those tribes. They used to be very rich, a lot of water, a lot of water, and very rich. And they have a lot of industry and factory and vegetations and cultivation, and you name it. Name it. So they used to live in complete blessing. That's why a lot of them, they become deceived and they forgot that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-mun'im. That's what we have to learn from this. When we're reading this ayat from Surah Saba, ayah number 15 to 17, لَقَدْ كَانَ لِسَبَئٍ فِي مَسْكَنِهِمْ آيَةٍ جَنَّتَانِ عَنْ يَمِينٍ وَشِمَالٍ كُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقَ رَبِّكُمْ وَاشْكُرُوا لَهُ بَلَّةٌ طَيِّبَةٌ وَرَبٌّ غَفُورٌ فَأَعْرَضُوا فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَيْلَ الْعَرِمِ وَبَدَّلْنَاهُمْ بِجَنَّتَيْهِمْ جَنَّتَيْنِ ذَوَاتَيْ أُكُلٍ خَمْطٍ وَأَثْلٍ وَشَيْءٍ مِّن سِدْرٍ قَلِيلٍ ذَلِكَ جَزَيْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَفَرُوا وَهَلْ نُجَازِي إِلَّا الْكَفُورُ. Allah Azza wa Jalla described those Saba', very beautiful civilizations, very rich civilizations, the gardens in the right and left. Gardens and blessing cultivations in the right and the left. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, كُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقِ رَبِّكُمْ. Eat, live. But there is a condition. وَشْكُرُوا لَهُ. There is a condition. What is that condition? Be thankful and grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you this. وَشْكُرُوا لَهُ. بَلْدَةٌ طَيِّبَةٌ وَرَبُّ الْغَفُورِ. It's a very rich, good country. بَلْدَة طَيِّبَة. Good. وَرَبْ غَفُور. Forgiving God. Forgiving merciful God. Then Allah Azza wa Jalla, فَأَعْرَضُوا. فَأَعْرَضُوا. They reject this civilization. It's this blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this is the result of the rejection, denying the bounty of Allah. فَأَعْرَضُوا فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَيْلَ الْعَرِمِ. Flood. Covering Yemen, the whole flood killed everybody. And the people start to migrate and leaving this beautiful country because the rejection of the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَبَدَّلْنَاهُمْ بِجَنَّتَيْهِمْ جَنَّتَيْنِ. Say that instead they have beautiful garden, they're covered by flood. Covered by flood. May Allah protect us from that. SubhanAllah Rabbil Alameen. And then Allah said, ذَلِكَ جَزَيْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَفَرُوا. This is the reward for the people denying the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَهَلْ نُجَازِي إِلَّا الْكَفُورُ. Who will punish? We punish only the disbelievers. May Allah protect us from that. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. And also in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ayat, you read those ayat in Surah Saba, says Allah, وَجْعَلْنَا بَيْنَهُمْ وَبَيْنَ الْقُرَى الَّتِي بَارَكْنَا فِيهَا قُرًا ظَاهِرَةً وَقَدَّرْنَا فِيهَا السَّيْرَ سِيرُوا فِيهَا لَيَالِي وَأَيَّامًا آمِنِينَ. قَالُوا رَبَّنَا بَاعِدْ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ أَسْفَارِنَا وَظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ. They was unjust and unfair with their own selves. This is the first civilization. The first civilization, call it civilization or Hadara in Arabic language, Hadara of Saba in Yemen. The second civilization, Hadarat Ad. Ad is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He mentioned that also in Surah Al-Shu'ara, in Surah Al-Shu'ara from ayah number 123 in Surah Al-Shu'ara, كذبت عاد المرسلين. Those Ad, they have very beautiful houses inside the mountain. Until today, there is some kind of trace among those civilizations. I say, those people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Hud and sent Salih to those people, but they deny. They deny, and then Shu'aib, they deny those messages. They deny the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It qala lahum akhuhum Hud, ala tattaqun. See, Hud, just last week we said that only 4 Arab prophets. Hud, one of them. And he's going to say, fear Allah, worship Allah. But they deny al-mursaleen. Al-mursaleen, they are the messengers, not one or two, but 4. We have 3 messengers before a prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they deny the message. And they deny him. And he said, inni lakum rasulun amin. Hud, telling those people, ahta'ad. Ad. Say, I am the messenger, believer in the prophet, believe in me, and they deny, but still Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed those people and vanished those people. May Allah protect us from that. Of course, there is Hadari Thamud also. Thamud, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, Ad wa Thamud. Ad wa Thamud, and also they deny the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the Thamud, it was in Hijaz. Al-Hijaz was close to Mecca. In Jeddah area, where is the Red Sea and that area. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, كذبت the قوم صالح, those people, the people of صالح alayhi salam, Prophet صالح alayhi salam. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Surah Al-Shu'ara also. Surah Al-Shu'ara 141. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, كذبت ثمود المرسلين إذ قال لهم أخوهم صالح ألا تتقون إني لكم رسول أمين فاتقوا الله واطيعون وما أسألكم عليه من أجر. All the messenger prophet, they say the same statement. وما أسألكم عليه من أجر. I don't want any reward. I don't want any money. I don't want anything from you. I want you just to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وما أسألكم عليه من أجر إن أجري إلا على رب العالمين. I get the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That in summary about the civilizations of those people before. Now what we learn, what we really, really learned from those people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them very smart, very intelligent. They have houses in every place, but this brain and this smart, they are not smart because to us is dumb, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave all this blessing and said, you deny, you don't thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're not grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala vanished those people. We learn when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you something, be thankful and grateful to Him. Thankful and grateful to Him. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ أَمْرُ عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُسْلِمِ إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ خَيْرٌ. I wonder for the matters of the believers, the matters of the people, the issues of the believers, all the matters is good. خَيْر, that's good. إِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ سَرَّاءَ شَكَرْ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. If there's good things happening to the believers, good things, and be thankful and grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's good for you. وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ ضَرَّاءَ صَبَرْ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. If there is calamity, hardship, calamity and hardship, something happened to you, so have sabr and patience. Sabr. فَكَانَ خَيْرًا, it's good for you. And this is only for the believer. In the end of the hadith, وَلَا يَكُنْ ذَلِكْ إِلَّا الْمُؤْمِنِ. Only for the believers. Not anyone have sabr for the calamity and hardship. only you need a true believer attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All right, now let's come now speaking about the situation of religious situation and political situation and the economic situation and society to the Arab. The religion issues or situation, the political situations, I'm not speaking about politics, but also the economic situation and the society and the morality to the Arab, to the Arab. Because we want to reach the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we want to understand this kind of situation before our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and how he grew up and how he was raised among in the middle of this kind of society. First, last week, if you remember, and I spoke about the Persian Empire, and subhanAllah, always the Arab area, either under the Persian Empire or under the Roman Empire. You know, this empire or this empire, they are followers. Always. They are either under the Persian Empire or the Roman Empire all the time. And sometimes the Persian defeat the Roman and the Roman defeat the Persian. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the beginning of Surah Ar-Rum. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام ميم غلبت الروم في أدنى الأرض وهم من بعد غلبهم سيغلبون في بضع سنين لله الأمر ومن قبل ومن بعد فالله سبحانه وتعالى describe غلبت الروم the Roman will be defeated غلبت الروم في أدنى الأرض in the area of Jericho the lowest place in the whole earth is the word أريحة in Palestine in that area they got defeated They got defeated في أدنى الأرض وهم من بعد غلبهم سيغلبون في بضع سنين After their defeat, they will be victorious. Allah Azza wa Jal gave the news to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم before this happened. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, because he's Siddiq, he's a truthful one. He said, this is going to happen. This is will happen. And he have some kind of bid before the bid become haram in Islam. And he have the bid with someone. And they, subhanAllah, This happened whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told in Ghulbat al-Rum and after a while, after a few years, they will be victorious and they become victorious. But in the end, it says, لِلَّهِ الْأَمْرُ مِنْ قَبْلِ وَمِنْ بَعْدِ وَيَوْمَ إِذِي يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ بِنَصْرِ اللَّهِ See, all the matters, they defeated or victorious in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But after that, after the Roman will be victorious, the Muslims they will be happy. يفرح المؤمن will we be happy why because we're gonna defeat them and this has happened all these sequences it's happened subhanallah rabbil alamin so let's speak about I say the Persian Empire they used to normally they worship everything they worship the king himself they worship animals they worship they used to even the situation they used to marry their own daughter their own sisters, their own aunt. The king himself, he married his own sister. Imagine this. That is in the Persian Empire and the Roman Empire and so on. So all those, you know, the situation, the religion situation, the Arabs, they don't have really a certain deen. They don't have, the Arab in that time, they don't have a certain belief. They believe in idols, statues, different area. And they consider that idol or that statues that is a connection between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what they believe. And there's many of them, say, Ya'uq, Ya'guth, Masr, Muna, Al-Uzza, and so on. Many, many of the names. Many names. I'm not going to go in details, but we know that they have many idols. And every tribe, they have their own god. If they don't have this god, they can have another god. In the rock sometimes, and different materials sometimes, and so on, and so on. Subhanallah, Rabbil Alamin. So, those idols is rocks, most likely. Rocks, most likely. So, every tribe, they used to believe in some certain things, wal-iyadu billah. But, some of those people, they still believe in the religion of Ibrahim, alayhi salam. You know, some people say, there is absolutely no religion, is that true? Waraq ibn Nawfal and some others, they used to believe And some people, they believe in Christianity, some people believe in Jewish religion, and some people, they believe in the tablet of Ibrahim alayhi as-salam. But not a lot. Not a lot, but there is. But there is. All right. Some people, they follow in the Sharia of Ismail alayhi as-salam, and so on and so on. That is the religion situation. So every tribe, they have their own idols or statues and believe in that statue. That statue will make them close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he have to fight every, not to fight, that argue in Mecca in the beginning. Every tribe alone. Mina and Azza and Nasr and Ya'uq and so on and so on. So every of those idols, the names of the idols. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to go to them and speak with them and argue with them about what this rock can do for you. What is the benefits? What is the benefits of this rock? And so on. That is the religious situation in that time. Roman, the same thing. And even they believe in Isa alayhi salam. Some of them, they believe in Isa alayhi salam as a god. Some of them believe in Isa alayhi salam as a son of God. Some of them believe in Maryam alayhi salam, and so on and so on and so on. You know the history behind this. But is not this deen or this religion is not spreading in Arabian Peninsula. It's not spreading in the Arabian Peninsula. This is the religion situation. Come to the political situation. Now come to the political situation. As I mentioned before, I said in Quraysh, there's many tribes. In Quraysh, many tribes. And there is also Badu and Hadar. Badu, that means Bedouins living in the desert. And some people, they have some kind of city, like Mecca, for example, and they live in it. And of course, the people is very strongly they defending their honor and their names, their family names. They most likely they are defending their family names more than defending anything else. So they choose Zaim al-Qabila, or the leader of the tribe, choosing about some kind of characteristics. He is strong, he is rich, he is from family, so and so and so. They choose a certain people, somebody good fighter, warriors, and so on, and they choose. So they choose the leader, and the leaders, whatever they can bring, he take 25% whatever they own. 25% rubu' ma yamliku, rubu', that's one fourth, whatever they get, they, that leader become rich after those people. So of course, we will speak about some Hilf al-Fudul, the confederation of al-Fudul, and that was in that time. The purpose of that confederation, that's just to protect the weak people. The people they have no tribe, the people they are weak, or people that take their rights or stealing their money. This group of people, confederation or party, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he have a chance to be part of this party one day, or the Hizb or confederation or confederation. So the political situation, as I said, they always belong to some great country like Persia or Roman, and they don't have a leader for the whole Arabian Peninsula. They are tribes, and the tribes attacking each other all the time and killing each other all the time. So there is no safety. And if you are strong, you live. If you are weak, you cannot live among in this kind of society. In this kind of society. Of course, this is in summary also. Come to the al-hala al-iqtisadiyya, or the economic situation. The economy situation. As you know, in the Arabian Peninsula, most likely there is a sahara or a desert. Desert does mean there is no water. Desert does mean there is no water. And normally the people live around the water. Normally people live around the water. There is water, they live. And the word now, like Jeddah, for example, in that civilization, until today, there's still people live in that area. A lot of people live among this area. But the city of Mecca, after Zamzam, and we're going to speak about Zamzam, inshallah, after Zamzam, they start to, people live around that area. And then Baytullah, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was built in Mecca. And even before the Islam, they used to perform Hajj. In time of Ibrahim alayhi salam, perform Hajj. As you know, the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he built the Kaaba with Ismail on the foundation of Adam. So the first one he built really the Kaaba is Adam alayhi salam. We're going to speak about this in more details. Then in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam was rebuilt again and so on. So Mecca, there is the water from Zamzam. From Zamzam. But most likely in economy, commerce and business and trades, they are very famous because the people, they come for Hajj and they bring their merchants with the merchandise and they sell it. So when we speak about the economy, we speak about this area become very rich because of the travelers and the tribes, they used to come and live and come with their business to this area. But of course, they deal with riba and interest a lot. Sometimes the interest goes, you know, 100%. Imagine this. I have some of the researching about interest and riba, 100%, imagine. So they used to deal with interest. Let's come to the الحالة الاجتماعية or the society situation, the society and community situation, society and community situation. In fact, those people, they really have this kind of tradition, the Arab tradition. Unfortunately, some people, they follow the same tradition from that time until today in that area. So the tradition, and then one of those traditions, for example, honored with the name and a rank and family and descent, they always proud and bargaining about it. This is number one about the name. They are bargaining. I am from this. I'm from Quraysh. I'm from that. So they are bargaining about or they're honored for their names and their descent and the descent. Number one. Number two, they are eloquent in language. And the word, their word used to, you know, the people, when they say a word with the poetries, they always like wisdoms, wisdom. So the Arabic language was very good also in that era, in that time. Let's speak about something also number three in the society or community about the woman. How is the woman in the Arab community on that time used to live? Believe it or not, the woman in that time used to be just like merchandise most likely. The man can marry his father's wife, that means his stepmother, and the father die, his son, he can marry that woman, or he can own that woman, that his stepmom, he can own it, wal-iyadu billah. So the woman, believe it or not, in that time, there is no value for the woman, no value for the woman. Before the Islam, and it's not only in the area where the Arabian Peninsula, Rome and Persia, worse, and they used to treat women just like merchandise, nothing else but that, or some for some purpose, no more than that. There is no respect. In fact, the woman cannot inherit in that time. Any woman or kids, they cannot inherit the father. Wal-iyadu billah. Imagine this. So of course, Allah, that when Islam came, make rules and regulation about the inheritance, and Allah Azza wa Jalla call this kind of science the inheritance, ilm al-fara'id, the science of al-fara'id, okay, the obligations, in the obligations. So, and then sometimes when the person used to kill his own daughters, we have a female, used to kill them. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in Surah Al-Takwir. وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بَأَيْذًا بِنْ قُتِلَتْ. With those people, they bury their daughters alive. Why she was killed? So the woman in that time, in general, there is no value for the woman, the females. No value for the females. Does not mean all the tribes like this. There is some tribes, they respect the woman, and they honor the woman. And the woman in some tribes, they have an opinion. She can become a leader, and they respect her in some tribes also. So it's not, we cannot generalize in some areas and some areas. But in general, women, they have no value. وَالْعِيَادَ بِاللَّهِ. This comes up with marriage, with the woman, without marriage. There is four types of marriage. One of the marriage is just like ours, or the Islamic marriage. You know, the man and the woman, they have to agree, and the wali, and the two witnesses, and the mahar. So all these procedures on that time and this time, it is the same. This is Aisha, Hadith Aisha radiallahu ta'ala. This is one kind. And some kind, the other three types is haram wal-iyadu billah. The other three types is haram. Let's say, like, for example, they have like the man, he's telling his own wife. Imagine that. He's telling his own wife, go to so and so, because you want a son who cannot have kids, go to so and so, have a relationship with him, and come back. And until he found out she's pregnant, he can have a relationship with his own wife. But she got pregnant from someone else. This kind of marriage they used to call it. Some other kids, like 10 men with one woman, and then when she become pregnant, she choose who is the father. She choose who is the father, wal'iyadu billah. And some other kind, a lot of everybody can have a relationship with that woman. And then when she become pregnant, she choose one of those people. And he cannot say, no, I'm not the father. Astaghfirullah al-Azim, the Islam can prohibit all these three types and assign or confirm with the first type, with the acceptance and wali and mahar and witnesses. And the Islam, subhanAllah, for the woman, they make rights and the whole surah called Surah Nisa, the whole surah called At-Talaq, the divorce, because in that time also when the woman she get divorced, she get zero, nothing. Nothing. She have no right even over the kids when she get divorced. But when the Islam came, make rules and regulations and honor the woman. And even before our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam die, he told us about take care of your wife, take care of your wife, take care of your wife. And the divorce, this is one of the very important, the man he used to divorce his wife hundreds of times. And he can get his wife back, just like a slave. Divorce and get back, divorce and get her back. And one in the time when the surah before Surah At-Talaq revealed, the one he told his wife, I will make you binding for the rest of your life, binding case for the rest of your life. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed At-Talaq marratan. At-Talaq, the divorce is twice. فَإِنْسَاكُ بِمَعْرُوفَ أَوْ تَسْرِيحًا بِإِحْسَانٍ. The divorce. The third time the set is done deal. Finished. Finished. So the Islam make rules and respect for the woman. She is not a slave for the man, he is his partner in life. Partner in life. Of course, one of the Arab society about the war and invasion, and as I said, one of the war, call it Yawm al-Basus. One of the war, call it Yawm al-Basus. Believe it or not, this war remain 40 years. Do you know why this war happened? Because someone killed the camel. One man killed the camel for different tribe, and the war start between these two tribes. Thousands of thousands got killed. Imagine this, because it's for a camel. There's another war called Dahis and Al-Ghabra. There is a race between horses, and one of the horses was like a Dahis, was like a good horse, fasting and racing, and someone killed him from different tribe. See, the war started for years and years in this kind of war. So about the war, they used to invade each other and killing each other, and for no reason, for very silly reasons, wal'iyadu billah. For silly reason, wal'iyadu billah. Okay. Also, in the society of the Arab in that time about reading and writing, it's not everybody actually read and write. It's very few people can read and write. Very, very few people can read and write. And subhanAllah, our deen is an obligation to read and write. So Allah Azza wa Jalla, the first ayah revealed, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. Read. الرحمن علم القرآن. Allah Azza wa Jalla. So Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he got the 70 of the people of the in Battle of Badr for ransom, teach 10 of the Muslims how to read or write. Imagine this. So the reading or writing and seeking knowledge, that is an obligation for the Muslims to seek the knowledge and to learn, inshallah Rabbani. So in that time, the reading or writing is very few, is not a lot of people that can read or write also. Come about the society of morals and characters. As I said, in that time, the invasion, and there's a lot of wine and liquor. That's why even the liquor and the wine, and when we prohibited the Islam in stages, not one time, because you people will be very alcoholic, very alcoholic, and gambling and so on. And about the zina, you know, the zina is like something normal. except al-hurra. Al-hurra, the decent woman from a good family like Hind, the wife of Abu Sufyan, she wonders, atazni al-hurra? She won one of the hadith. She said, atazni, that means the free woman with a good descent and good family, she committing adultery? She wondered if somebody can do something like this. So the adultery and fornication was there, but not with the decent families and decent people, but it was. But something, it was really unique, because there is no writing and reading, but they used to be smart and intelligent. They can memorize, for example, a poetry. There are some competition in Mecca, the Islam poetry. For 100 line can person just listen to that poetry once and can just memorize it. Just memorize the whole poetry. And then when I'm talking about very hard language, very hard language, as Sha'r al-Qadim, the old poetry is very, very hard. But still the people, they believe, some of them, they believe in the philosophy and the myth of the Greeks. The philosophy and the myth of the Greeks, they used to believe. Also, that society about al-karam and al-sakha, the generous. Then even they are not Muslim, but they are very, very generous. Very generous. Somebody come and slaughter for him, even that person is a poor, but still is honor his guest. That person honoring his guest. And also, the people of they are brave. They are brave and protecting the needy, some of them, as it says, the Confederation of Al-Fudul, and we're going to speak about it in more details, inshallah. So because the people live in the desert, so they're free, they always love to be free. They have the common freedom. But what you see in the Arab world right now, it is not normal for the Arab. It's not normal for the Arab. Because normally those are of this society, they love freedom. They love freedom. Because they live in the desert, as I said. And fulfilling their covenant and promises become this the honored people. They always fulfilling their promises and their covenant as well. As I said, they are really a lot of them, because they are always fighting, and they have this kind of bravery, and they are a lot of them. They are strong. As I said, they choose the leader according to some criteria and some characteristics, and that they're strong. The majority of them, they are strong. They are strong. Here, come some kind of events. Some kind of events before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and. Before the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we will speak about it, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen, next week. Subhanakallahu wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Ya Allah.